Welcome everybody, you're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. Today, we will parse some nested JSON data using new techniques, but first, we need to go through the Twitter API to retrieve these data. I was asked by a viewer to put two of my previous videos together to show how I did it, but today I'm using new techniques for solving this problem. I'd like to say thank you to the new subscribers and recent viewers. I greatly appreciate it. You're going to need to import a few things, so let's get that out of the way. You need pandas, collections, base64, request, JSON, and default dictionary. You will need to have a standard Twitter account as well as a developer account established before you get this done if you're interested in the API portion. So let's get into looking at this real quick. You have this authentication page that has useful functions that you're going to use. We're going to scroll down and look at the basic layout, our template of how we're going to set this up. So it looks like you're doing a post call and you're calling an OAuth to. You're retrieving data from the API. You have an authorization where it says something basic. And you have this funky looking thing, which would be your key. Then you have this content type, which is standard for your application that you're using. And then you have this grant type that we need to snag as well. So you would put your secret key and your client keys both here. I would suggest using a fig file if possible. We need to do some string formatting so we can actually send these keys off. Well, we were going to use our client key, a client secret key, and then we need to do some encoding and convert that into ASCII. You will call in base64, then you need base64 encode, and you're just going to call in the key secret that you just created, and we will then have to decode this, so we're going to call base64, and then you need b64 code key, and then we're going to say decode it into ASCII. Nope. Encode, if I could spell correctly today. And we need to look at something called an OAuth. It's basically just a protocol giving your application permission to act on its behalf, and you're not sharing any of the personal information such as your password. And there's a few ways that you can actually grant this type of permission: authorization, client credentials, and passwords. And you could look at the distinction between these. I left some documentation if you're interested in going further into figuring this out. We go back and we look at the setup, and we would notice that we're setting up our API, where you're calling in your token with your authorization of 2, your OAuth 2, which is using the public data versus the private data for OAuth 1, and you're using a bearer token, all right? So we're calling in this authorization, and you have that basic, and this is where the key is getting stored, and everything is the same as the example I showed in here. Then you call this in, so then you send this in and you get a response code of 200. If you make too many calls repeatedly in a short amount of time, you get an error. It's going to stop you from that, so just be aware. And setting this up in basically the order that kind of falls, all right? So then you have the JSON response, which is basically token type and your access token. And if you printed it off, you see it's just this jumble looking like hash looking thing, if you're curious. We'll do the OAuth 1 for a GET request, and you have some parameters. So we're going to look at those parameters, and you have your only required one here, which is basically giving you a max character length of 500, including your operators. I'm also going to use the count, which will give a max of 100 items per page. I'm only going to do 50. You have other optional parameters that you can use. And so we're going to do our GET request. We're using our OAuth of 1.1, calling in that API. We're going to have the tweets in JSON formatting, and this queue is your cert. You have three options here. You have popular, recent, and mixed. You have, in this case, they're looking for results of NASA, and then it's all the same other stuff if you read into this. Now, we're going to look for climate change today and the most recent, and it's basically the same setup as the post. And what does the actual tweet look like when you're doing this? The tweet looks like this. So you have an outer portion, which would be your statuses, and then everything falls in as a list of dictionaries, of which some are extremely nested. Using the text, which is the actual tweet, is what most people would use for some kind of natural language processing. But in this case, we're going to delve into it and practice parsing nested data. So if you only wanted the tweets, you would stop here and you'd iterate through the statuses and look for the text, which is inside of it. And I decided to print off the first text here. For our convenience, we're going to take the statuses and keep everything. So you can see that we have the dictionaries. And how long is this? It should be 50. So we store this into a list. Then let's look at what this would be as a data frame. And that's fine. It looks like everything's good until you scroll over and you see here that you have dictionaries with lists of values. You have other dictionaries. You can keep scrolling on. Now, this is what we're going to play with. There's a few ways you can go about this. First thing is looking at the columns, and you could actually pull all the columns that are objects, start iterating through those and figure out which ones are dictionaries or not, and manipulate from there if that's what you wanted to do. That's one route. You can look at this by row-wise and consider looking at all of the columns and see which ones print off dictionaries and then manipulate from there. I decided that I'm going to use the data frame route. So let's look into this. Let's take our data and create just some dummy random list. And I want to iterate through this for the JSON tweet data. And let's take our statuses. And we need to then iterate with inside of the data. Let's go inside the statuses. We're going to iterate through each one of these. I need to convert it into values. And then if the type of J is an actual dictionary, then I would like to append I and J, where I is basically the index value. And that's what's going on here. So what's up with this? Let's look at this a little bit. So I'm going to take the first entry of this that I converted into values. So it was taking this and converting it into a list. And this is the first entry within that list. And what I'm looking for specifically is anything that's a dictionary. Any of the other values that aren't a dictionary, I could just call those out later and concatenate it to the data frame. But you'll notice that that's not needed or unnecessary because this same data right here is stored within the nested data we'll find later. All right. So we have now basically the row number that all of data is corresponding to as our index with all of our nested entries. So what do we do with this? We need to create a default dictionary list so we can store our key value pairs, okay? Where our values are going to be the list. So let's iterate through this, and we're going to append to our dictionary list the key, which is our index, and we're going to append our values into this. What's this look like? So here's our first entry where we have a list of all our nested dictionaries. Okay, so we're getting somewhere. Then we're going to take these data, and let's just name it something fun. Let's just call it DFA. So I'm going to call in a data frame so I can store these data. But I need to do something really interesting here, okay? I'm going to call in my data, but I'm going to take my key and convert my value to a series, and my key will basically be the column number. And then we need to iterate through K and V in the list that we just made. We're going to call this as a dictionary, so it's going to get the items, and let's see what this looks like. Okay, this is interesting, right? But it says that we have 50 columns when we should have 50 rows. So we need to transpose this. Now we have 4 columns and 50 rows, which is more like what we need. But what's going on with this? Why do we have 4 columns? Well, it split these up into distinguished dictionaries, which is very useful. And if you notice at the very beginning, you always have something that's created at, all right? So we're getting somewhere pretty useful. How can we deal with this now? Because it's all dictionaries, values of list and miscellaneous information. So let's look into this. So let's do some converting. That's where import JSON is going to come in handy. So let's make this some variable, I don't know, JSON structure, I guess, or structor, however you want to think of this. And this is called JSON loads, which is for JSON strings. And we're going to convert the data that we have into a JSON object. And we need to orient this as records. And what does this even look like? This is kind of funky, right? Okay, so we got a list of dictionaries corresponding to some key, which is our index. Okay, so let's see how this actually gets used. So we can take our data and we can say JSON normalize. We say JSON normalize. We take our little struct that we just created. And what does that do? Ooh, that's interesting. So let's look at something real quick. So you have your data, which is nested dictionaries, and you've now unnested it to a point. I say this because these values here were actually lists of further dictionaries, so you need to do further processing. So we started from however many columns here. You started from 4 columns here. Your nested data now exploded into 121 columns, where we need to do further processing on this right here. Okay. One thing you can look into is saying there's an option that can work in separate circumstances I've never covered before, which is called explode, which would be calling in our data frame, and then you call in the explode, and what column would we like to take? Let's just make one up. Let's just take this one. Let's see what it looks like. So if you see here, there is a difference because it got rid of the list. And I made a function that I'm not using today, which was shown in my previous video, and I'll put a card for that, where you can actually separate this column here after you've got rid of the list and unnest that. So this is one option depending on what your circumstances that you can use. It's pretty useful, except in this case, it partially helps. What do we do from this? Let's break up that column with a list of dictionaries and see how we can do this. So let's call in our trusty old, let's call in this column and see how this can work. So let's throw in this specific column and let's use an apply function. And I'm going to convert this into a series. So I'm taking this nested data and I'm going to convert it into a new pandas series. We're going to use the JSON dot loads once again, like we did above, take in our nn variable, convert this into a JSON, and we're going to orient this equals records like we did in the previous example. And then we're going to do the JSON normalize for the new variable we have. And let's look at what this turns out to be. Okay, so what's going on with this? Looks crazy. You have a lot of column now. So what happened? We took in this specific column and we created more columns. All right. So we just basically broke up that nested data into these columns. It turns out to be 18 columns, if I'm correct, from that one column that we just manipulated. And mind you, you have 40 or so more columns to do the same type of thing with. So this is going to expand to way over. You're going to be at more than 238 columns that you have to sift through. Needless to say, let's look at this. So in doing this, I generated columns that were duplicates, and I want to remove those. But let's first concatenate onto the data that we were dealing with. And I'm going to take in this. And so now we have 135 columns in this circumstance. Each time you run the Twitter API, you're getting new tweets. Sometimes when I did this, it was 238 columns. At this point, it's 138 columns. But let's find out how much of those 135 columns, are actually duplicates. So we're going to drop some columns. And I want my axis to be along the columns, but you need to say, how do you want this to happen? Usually it just says any, but I want all. So if the column has all NAs, drop it. Okay, so we have 115 columns now instead of 135. But why do I have 100 rows? I should have only 50 rows. There I am. That's what happens if you're not paying attention. We want this along the columns, so we keep the rows. Perfect. Let's look at something real quick. Let's print this off. So it looks like in this circumstance of running these data, I had 14% of my columns, which were duplicate columns, which was 1% less than what I had before, which is interesting. And you have to take that into consideration when you're using these data. Now I didn't move this along further because you have to run this basically for each one of these issues you have for any one of these columns. And so in order to finish this up and take care of each individual column and explode this into a really wide data set, we'd have to iterate through each one of these column wise and do a comparison of basically either data type or use a combination of functions. But that's up to the end user to figure out how to do it. I just show that you can take that one column here, convert it into multiple columns and unnest it. That's what I showed here. I showed how you can use the JSON normalize to flatten out your data. And I also showed the explode, how you can get rid of list if you had a column where your values were a list of multiple values, how you can use explode to get rid of that list. And if you had like a tuple or if you had something like that, be able to align it per the rows. Another thing I would suggest is changing the column names data and getting rid of this because that notation's for what the original column was that it was nested within. You could do some string formatting for these names. Anyway, I would like to say thank you for watching. Please like, share, and subscribe. And if you subscribe, turn on that notification bell. I hope this brought utility to someone. See you in the next video. Bye.